Hi, AP Psych. Welcome to lecture number 3 in Unit 1, Scientific Foundations. This lecture is all about ethics and the treatment of humans and animals in research studies and experiments. These are the learning targets provided by College Board. Feel free to pause and take a read. Okay, we're going to begin with a story to demonstrate the importance of ethics. In 1932, there was no known treatment for syphilis, and so the Tuskegee Institute decided to study a group of men to see what happened to their bodies over the course of their life if they had syphilis. So they recruited approximately 600 men, some with syphilis, some without, and these men were often, or mostly, I should say, not often, mostly black sharecroppers who were low income, not very well educated, and who had never had access to a doctor before. So they were promised things like free medical care. And so when they had the opportunity to participate in the study, they took it. However, all of these men were given a placebo. Remember, the study was to see what happened to men who had syphilis over the course of their life, not to treat it or make it go away. So no actual medicine was given. This study was set at first to go on for 6 months and went on for 40 years. These men never gave informed consent. We're going to come back to that term. They never gave informed consent, meaning when they agreed to participate in the study, they were not informed that they weren't actually going to be getting the medicine. Now, you are allowed to give a placebo as long as you also say that that's a possibility. So you say to the participants, if you're going to participate in this study, there's a chance that you will not get medical treatment. These men were not told that. They were promised that they were indeed going to get medical care. This study went on for 40 years. Over the course of the 40 years, 28 of the participants passed away from syphilis, 100 of the participants passed away from complications related to syphilis, numerous spouses contracted it from the men, and even babies were born with syphilis already in their blood. All of this was exposed in 1972 by the Associated Press. Once it came to light in the public, the case was brought to Congress, and eventually there was a $10 million settlement from the Tuskegee Institute to the heirs of the deceased participants. So why is this important? I want you to pay attention to that no informed consent piece. And we're going to move on, but we'll come back to that and we'll be able to make that connection very shortly. So just like the United States government or your state or city government makes laws, who makes the rules determining whether or not something is ethical? Well, the body of rules is called the Code of Ethics, and it's written by, in the United States, it's written by the APA, the American Psychological Association. It was created in 1953, and it is used by something called the Institutional Review Board. So most research is conducted and monitored by the institution where it's happening, most often a university. And each university has an IRB that controls whether or not a study is approved. So if I'm a researcher, I'm going to write up my whole study. I'm going to explain the steps I'm going to take. And then I'm waiting for their approval. They will look it over and look at the code of ethics and make sure it meets their approval. If it does, I can continue on. If it does not, I need to alter my study for when they're determining whether or not a study is ethical. Here's that informed consent piece I was talking about a couple minutes ago. When a participant is agreeing to participate in a study, they must be informed of every aspect of the study that would influence their decision as to whether or not to participate, and ensure that participation is voluntary. So if those men knew that it was a possibility they would get a placebo, then it would have been informed consent. But those men thought they were all going to get medicine, and so it was not informed consent. Now, we do a lot of studies, and we're going to be talking about a lot of studies involving children. Children on their own cannot provide written consent. So in addition to getting the consent of the parents, a researcher needs to continuously get assent. In other words, continuously checking in with that child. Are you comfortable? Are you okay? Would you like to stay? Would you like to go? And that sort of thing. This can get a little bit murky. So a lot of times the children participants are the children of professors or other members of the faculty of that university. The next item is limited deception. You must only deceive people when it is absolutely essential to the study, and you must tell about that deception at the end of study during the debriefing. So let's say, for example, you want to find out if one human is willing to hurt another human. What you could do, for example, would be set up, let's just say, a big red button and tell the participant, if you push this button, it's going to electrocute someone in the other room. This will relate to another study we're going to learn about later in this year, but for the moment, just go with me. You are probably going to lie to that subject and tell them that that button will electrocute that person in the other room, but you're not actually going to electrocute the person in the other room. That would not be ethical. But you are allowed to deceive the participant into thinking that if they hit that button, they will electrocute someone in the other room. Because you're trying to test out whether or not the human that you're actually studying, the button pusher, would do it. So you are allowed to lie to your subject as long as you tell them about that lie at the end of the study. And that is the debriefing, and we're going to get to that shortly. Kind of going hand in hand with my example about the electrocution is you must protect your subjects from harm and discomfort. You must minimize any discomfort or risk involved in the study and must act to prevent participants from suffering any long-term negative consequences. So you cannot actually electrocute someone to the point where they are permanently scarred or actually hurt or their life and well-being is actually in danger. You probably could give them a little zap as long as it's in a safe zone and as long as, again, they have consent that they might get zapped or have given consent that they might get zapped. And then the other important point is that all participants must have the ability to leave at any time. The next item is confidentiality. When we study some of the famous experiments and research throughout psychology, I'll often say names. Most of the time, the names that I'm saying for the sake of the story are made up. They might be code names. The names are changed to protect someone's identity. Someone might even just be given a number. So personal information about the participants must be kept a secret. However, relevant information to the study can still be included as long as the personal information is not disclosed. At the end of the study, there must be a debriefing where participants are told exactly what the study was about and whether or not any deception was going on. Oh, and then participants must leave the study in the same way that they arrived. For example, if someone is trying to study the effects of alcohol on a subject, they can get that subject drunk with their informed consent, as long as they make sure that they are sober and back to normal when they leave the lab. A really good strategy for learning all of these very quickly is to remember the phrase, I do care about research participants. I, informed consent. D&D, deception and debriefing. You can deceive as long as you debrief it after the research is over. Confidentiality, review board or IRB, and protection from harm. I do care about research participants. Hopefully that helps you learn that. Okay, the next topic is ethics involving animals. Why do we even study animals in the first place? Well, their behavior is interesting in and of itself, and we have learned quite a bit by studying animals like chimpanzees and dolphins and even mice, but relating it specifically to human behavior and psychology, we can often learn information that would be impossible or unethical to get from humans, or maybe learn information at its very basic level to then be applied to humans at a more complicated level. Animals are generally not subjected to extreme pain, starvation, or other inhumane conditions. And researchers are going to hurt animals, it must, and the IRBs will check for this, it must be deemed necessary to benefit human welfare. So there must be an extreme reason and way that it could ultimately help humans before we're going to potentially hurt an animal to conduct the research. There are guidelines how to care for animals just as there are for humans. And if you are interested, we're not going to have time to watch this in class, but if you are interested in more having to do with animal research, I encourage you to check out Franz De Waal's TED Talk, Do Animals Have Morals? And it really discusses this whole idea of researching animals and what we can learn about them in relation to humans. So you might want to check that out. Okay, when talking about animals, who says it's ethical as opposed to talking about humans? Again, the APA's Code of Ethics is in play, and animal research must also be approved by an institutional animal care and use committee. So kind of like an IRB, only they specialize in the treatment of animals. And just like we have the phrase, I do care about research participants to help us remember the ethical codes for the treatment of humans, we have this something similar for the treatment of animals, and that is the ABCs. All research involving animals must be appropriate, not cruel and unusual. It must be beneficial to human psychological research, so it must be like a step towards researching human behavior. And it must consider the caring of the animal in terms of regulating the number of cages, the size of the cages, are they being kept clean, and are animals being given proper food? So that's our discussion on ethics.